We'll start with the prayer.
योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचा मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि आबाहु पुरुषाकारं शङ्खचक्रासिधारिणं सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतं प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिं गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः हरिः ॐ
बावरां तु पतञ्जलि गुरुजी इस् द पान्स् एण्ड् देन् लेट्स् गो Anger Yogshala Nigdi, Pune welcomes all of you. Pavitra, I want to introduce Pavitra. So I want Pavitra to be. Pavitra joined our Yogshala as a teacher, teaching Thursday morning 7 a.m. online class. She is grand daughter-in-law of Guruji, and she was initiated by him to yoga after her marriage. While learning from Guruji, she also learned from Geeta and Prashant during their classes. She did even some other senior teachers' classes also in the institute, our Ramamani Iyengar Memorial Yoga Institute. She used to discuss many things with, of course, Guruji, with Geeta, Prashant, with, you know, like one-to-one discussions. And that is how she learned lots of things while practicing herself. Basically, she has got researching mind. She wanted to do PhD, got married, missed the bus to join PhD. But basically, as she has got that researching mind, she started exploring in the yogic field as she boarded the spaceship of yoga and started her own researching on her own way, learning many, many things. So one of the aspects she is going to present to all of us. Over to Pavitra now. Welcome, Pavitra. And start your presentation.
Thank you, Sunita ji. Good evening, everyone. Namaskar. Before I start with the presentation, I just would like to say a few things with you. As an individual, I'm an introvert. But I have a strong educational and a professional background in science. as she said. I believe in science, logic, facts, experiment, experience, and reason. But I also believe in God. My journey into yoga started only after I got married to my husband, my Harit, after I moved to Pune from Chennai. Guruji B.K. Iyengar, my husband's grandfather, became my Tata as well. Tata meaning grandfather. His family became my family. That's life. Gradually, Tata became my guru. This single sentence is self-explanatory. Nothing more to say. I am not here today to share, to tell you what kind of experiences I had with him. I'm not here to do that. I'm here for something else. I never questioned my guru. When he said, start life.
Request everyone to please mute. Request everyone to please be on mute. I'm going to mute everyone. The speaker has to unmute yourself.
So when he said, do Urdhva Dhanurasana, I did Urdhva Dhanurasana. Do Kurmasana, I did Kurmasana. Do Setubandhasana, I did Setubandhasana. Next slide. Likewise, Shirshasan, Kapotasan, I did all of them. But end slide. But my asanas were never perfect. Some okay, some bad, some even worse. I let go of my profession and I followed him. All I knew was I was closer to my guru. Everything changed when he passed away. I started questioning everything. Why am I here? Why am I doing this? Why should I do this? Why should I continue this? Everything. But it was after one of Prashantji's pranayam classes. Many things, you know how you're all familiar with how his classes are. So many thought provoking things that he said. It was after one of his classes, I realized that I cannot pursue yoga just because I'm feeling closer to my guru. I cannot pursue yoga just because I'm feeling closer to God. I got to have something solid. So it came to my senses, to reach God is not alone yoga, but the journey that I take meanwhile is also yoga. I started going back to my basics. I started applying my limited scientific knowledge, experience, that education in my practice. Geetaji and Sunitaji, they encouraged me. They listened to all my thoughts, my ideas, with such patience. Geetaji mentored me in her practice, in my practice, classes, and in my studies. She was also the one who taught me knowledge is to be shared, no matter how trivial you think it is. I'm here today to do that. Thank you, Sunitaji, for your constant support, for giving me this platform. So let us begin with the presentation. This is the topic of today's presentation. Introduction to human body, anatomy and physiology in asanas. Next slide. For the next 90 minutes, I'll be covering the following. Some amazing facts on human body to plant the seed of fascination into you. A peek at the internal and external human anatomy, physiology in asanas, few asanas as examples to get an idea how physiology works. And here, how science can be used as a tool to understand Guruji's teachings better. That is the most important thing of today's topic. What after getting fascinated? Next slide. Well, before you keep wondering, before you start bombarding your brain with so many questions about me, this is about me. I'm not a qualified doctor or a medical practitioner. I'm a graduate in microbiology postgraduate in biotechnology. I was a research fellow in one of the Asia's top eye hospitals. And as Sunita ji said, I have studied under Geeta ji, Prashant ji, and Sunita ji, Guru ji. And let us get on to the other topic. Now you know. Enough talking about me. Next slide. So why is it important? Now, let us be very plain. Okay, knowing anatomy knowledge is going to avoid injury. And you know, when you practice, it is better to have this knowledge to understand to, you know, where the blood flow increases, where the postural correction has to change or take place, where to treat ailments and symptoms, and how to help others with similar problems. And it is also a part of Swadhyaya, to progress and evolve in practice. Yes, science has its own limitations, I agree, but science is also a known knowledge. So let us start from there before searching for the unknown. As Geeta ji said, every asana should be done with japa, artha, and bhavana. Next slide. Okay, I was telling you about anatomy and physiology. What is anatomy and what is physiology? Before I do this, this is for a bigger, wider group with some people might not have been having any scientific background. So I'm trying to put it as simple as possible. Okay, so anatomy means the biology that that is concerned with the structure of organisms. So for in this case, it's us. For today, it's us. It can be either macroscopic or microscopic. Macroscopic means that can be anything that can be seen with the naked eyes. Microscopic means you need a, say for example, a microscope, a scanning electron microscope, which Prashant ji used to say very often, in order to see those cells and tissues, how they look. Where an anatomist is more concerned with the shape, size, position of the organs. Take for example, a very common example, liver. A physiologist, for example, he is more interested in how the organ functions. In this case, as I told you, the liver, what is the production of, how the production of bile is, what the liver does for in nutrition, how does it regulate the body functions, and all that. Okay, next slide.
Yes, this slide, as I told you, the first, remember, the first one I told you, to get you fascinated by our human body. So these are some of the facts that got me fascinating. So I hope that you will also find it fascinating. So as I, the first thing is the human body contains about 100 trillion cells. And every second, imagine 25 million new cells are formed. As Adi Shankaracharya said, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. So where there is a birth, there is also death. About 50,000 cells in our body dies by the time you read this sentence. Amazing, isn't it? An average adult takes over 20,000 breaths a day. This thing Prashant ji used to say very often in his classes. In the morning, a person is about 8 mm taller than in the evening. Skin is the largest organ in the body, and you lose about 4 kgs of skin every year. Come on, give me a break. I wish that I could shed that that much of weight. The human heart beats more than 3 billion times and pumps about 182 million liters of blood. Wow. Each day, the kidneys process about this much of blood, about 190 liters of blood to filter about 1.9 liters of waste and water. And the largest bone in the human body is femur. The smallest bone is the ear bone. And about 20% of the oxygen supply goes to our brain. Next slide. Okay, these are some numbers. And in continuation with the last slide,
when I say human anatomy and physiology, these numbers will give you a clue, the scale and the depth of the subject that we are dealing with, right? So like, we have about 206 bones, 300 at birth, and we have about 700 named muscles, 7 trillion nerve cells, 5 liters of blood, 79 different organs and growing. You must have known that recently a Dutch scientist have found out one more organ. So it's the number is growing. Slide. We have about 11 organ systems, 1,300 enzymes in a single cell, 50 different hormones. And the hierarchy that you see, the picture that you see in the side, that shows the basic hierarchy, like, you know, how the cells, group of cells form tissues. A group of tissues form organs. A group of organs form organ systems. And a group of organ systems as a network, we form an organism, right? I hope that you had got this thing. Next slide. Human anatomy. This is external and internal. External is it's a child's play. You know, my daughter's 5-year-old daughter says that head, nose, ear, arms, legs, knees, and everything. Whereas internal, if somebody cuts us open, this is how we look, right? Brain, lungs, liver, heart, stomach, intestines, bladder. This is how the internal anatomy looks, the major organs. Next slide. Now, as I said, that we have about 79 organs, known organs. All these are easily identifiable organs that anybody will know. Brain, heart, lungs, stomach, intestines. They all have their own functions. But it is important for us to understand that each organ, they differ in size, shape, location, and function. But these organs, they work together by the end of the day. They might be different entities, but they work together in order for the overall well-being of the human embodiment. Next slide. Yes. Now, macrocosm is in microcosm and vice versa. Guruji's quote. Now, as I said, that a group of organs form organ systems. Now, we have about 11 organ systems. I'll just read out the names for you, because in case if it's too small, integumentary system, muscular system, skeletal system, cardiovascular system, nervous system, respiratory system, digestive system, urinary system, reproductive system, endocrine system, and immune system. Now, as I told you before, a group of organs, they form this organ systems. A single organ system can have multiple organs in itself. For example, integumentary system. What is integumentary system? It has got skin, hair, and nails, multiple organs. What about cardiovascular system? It has got heart and blood vessels, like that. Okay, lymphatic system, for example, it has got lymph nodes, it has got lymphatic vessels, lymph organs, lymphatic tissues, again, a multiple thing. And that's what each and every organ system is an ocean by itself. This one hour is not enough for us to, you know, go through all those systems. And that is why macrocosm is in microcosm and vice versa. Next slide. Okay, now that we have some idea how our anatomy looks, how we look both inside and outside, we'll bring yoga into this. Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga, you know this, you're all practitioners of yoga. We have eight limbs, Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi. Now, remember, recollect, you know, how in our college days, we used to have a theory class and a practical class, right? Practical class is where we get to experiment, we get to experience, we get to feel the subject. Likewise, Patanjali is a very smart guy. Yeah? He thought that we should have some practical things in that can be done so that we can implement all those philosophical and spiritual aspects in our life. So I believe, and that is why asana and pranayama comes into picture. Today we'll be dealing about asana. Pranayama is, again, physiology of pranayama is huge, is humongous. I'm not going to deal with that today, some other day, probably. Okay, next slide. Okay, anatomy and physiology in asana. Now here, we all start our practice. Start our asana classes with Tadasana. It's a very basic foundation pose. So I thought that I will also start with Tadasana. Okay, so this is Tadasana, mountain pose. Now the picture that is next to you is the skeletal system. I have shown the skeletal and muscular system here because as beginners, we all deal with penetrating these systems first, you know, mobilizing your joints, using your hands and legs more. You get to mobilize your body, your mind, your breath, and all that. Skeletal and muscular system is being depicted here. You can all see the alignment of joints, bones, slight.
Just a minute.
Yes.
Just a minute, you're on mute. Can you? Yes.
So Guruji used to say that there is Tadasana in every asana. So it doesn't mean that all asanas where the hands and legs are straight and all that, but look at how all those joints are aligned, how the bones are aligned, how the muscle, how the energy flow of the muscles are, from where it starts, from where it begins. So that has to be maintained in every asana, no matter how much ever advanced asana we do, that alignment has to be maintained. And that is why he said there is Tadasana in every asana. Shirshasana I have shown here because it's a reverse Tadasana. How beautifully he does, you know, I can't make out a difference at all. If you just flip-flop the photo, it becomes Tadasana. Beautiful. Next slide. Okay. This one is the vertebral column, the backbone. Now, as you can see here, this is the vertebral column. Vertebral column, very commonly called a spinal column as well. You can see different regions of the vertebral column here. Cervical region, thoracic region, lumbar, sacrum, and coccygeal region. Coccyx is nothing but very commonly called as tailbone. You would have heard about this in your classes as well. Now, here, slide. The next image, the right side image, there you can see the alignment, the positioning of the different organs around the vertebral column. You can see how the heart is tilted. The top of the heart is tilted towards the dorsal spine, tilted towards the back. Now you can see the placement of the kidneys near the floating ribs. You can see where the diaphragm is. And you can see where the intestines are, where the stomach is. You know, this is with this picture. I hope that you will be able to recollect and connect how, when your teachers say, dig your dorsal spine in concave back positions, because that has got a very good reach to your heart. We also talk about the curvature in Viparita Dandasana and Setubandha Sarvangasana. somewhere around the floating ribs. So you can see for the near the floating ribs, the kidneys are there. So you can, there is a connection, there is a reason, there is a way for us to access the internal organs when you access your spinal column. So that is why in every asana, spinal column, the vertebral column is very important. Next slide. Now here. The previous slide, I showed you the vertebral column, right? So that is how the vertebral column looks when the person is upright. Now in figure A, this lady is arching back, like how we used to go in arching back or Urdhva Dhanurasana and all that, right? And the figure B shows forward bends, Uttanasana. We bend forward to do Uttanasana, Prasarita Padottanasana and all this, okay? So observe, look closely how the shape of the vertebral column becomes different when a person is arching back and when a person is bending forward. And you can easily relate it to the asana that has been showed in the side. How Guruji has actually started arching back. He's the second slide, still more back. His arms have been released in the third picture. Now he has done Urdhva Dhanurasana. He has come back to the final asana. So in each and every step he does that, the shape of the vertebral column is different. Likewise, in forward bends, Uttanasana, concave back again. We say that sharpen your spine in your forward bends. Lengthen your spine in forward bends. So this is the reason, because the shape of the spinal column is different. Next slide. Now this is a very closer view of how the spinal column, the vertebral column behaves in forward bend and back bend. Now the one which I've written skin is the skin, okay? Now this vertebral column, there are two vertebrae, and the space that you see in between is the disc. Now in forward bends, see this, can you please show which is the anterior spine? This is the anterior spine. Posterior spine is back. This is the posterior spine. Now in forward bends, see how the space in the anterior spine is lessened. But where it becomes vice versa in back bending asanas, where the posterior spine space is being reduced. So that is why now here it has to be connected. When Guruji says, lengthen your spine, vertebra, there has to be space between each and every vertebra. Point by point, if we have to lengthen. So when he says that we have to do this only, that the space between the anterior and the posterior spine, it cannot be like this. They should be equal. That is our main criteria. And as you can see, all these asanas, the hand and leg positions, they vary, right? Now to access the spine is extremely difficult. And that is why we have a gradation in asanas. Start with something very simple. And then you gradually go to advanced asana. For example, here I have shown the first picture is Adho Mukha Svanasana. Adho Mukha Svanasana, begin your asana class with Adho Mukha Svanasana. Now see how much he has lengthened his spine in Adho Mukha Svanasana. Maintaining that length, do Janu Shirshasana and see what happens. Now maintaining this length that you had got in Adho Mukha Svanasana, do Urdhva Mukha Svanasana and see what happens. The same thing with this spinal length, you have to do an advanced asana like Ek Padraj Kapotasana. Now we as practitioners, I don't think that some of us cannot reach this much of spinal length. That is not possible for us. This is where the props come into picture. Okay, take some bricks for your hand in Urdhva Mukha Svanasana, where the spinal length can be increased. Rope one comes into picture. And all those different props, they make you to reach this goal, to lengthen the spine, spinal column, to where the anterior spine and the posterior spine space is common, is even, and then you do the asanas. Slide, next slide. Okay, now this is a photo, a combination of asanas you can see. Okay, it has got a wide range. It has got a supine asana, it has got a forward bend group, back bending group, twisting, inversions, sitting. Now, what do you see when you look at all these asanas? Are they simply skeletomuscular actions? I don't think so. Now, for example, that is obvious, right? Whatever, yes, of course, the skeletal, the skeletomuscular systems is involved here. That is obvious. But Guruji used to say this very often in his classes, that our mind goes behind, always tends to go behind what is obvious. Asanas will teach you how to look at the not obvious things. So what is not obvious behind behind all these asanas is the physiology involved behind this. For example, Ashtavakrasana, or we can say that it is an arm balancing pose. Yes, strength is required, lot of muscular action is required. But imagine how much the central nervous system has got to work in order to have a balance. How much the ear bones have to communicate to the brain to have a balance. How much the mind should be unwavering in order to balance this asana. So likewise, each and every asana has got a physiology on its own. We have to, those are all unobvious, not obvious things. We have to look all beyond the obvious things. Now, when Guruji says organic, bring organic action in asanas, what does he mean? Now, just so you know, now that the hands and legs, we have our hands and legs. Now, hands and legs, they are nothing but skeletal muscles. These skeletal muscles, they are controlled by somatic nervous system. Now, somatic nervous system, they are voluntary. They bring about voluntary actions, which means that I can control the movement of hands and legs. I can control this. But the organs inside our body and the glands inside our body, they are made up of different kind of muscles. They are smooth muscles. They are cardiac muscles. Now, they are all controlled by autonomous nervous system. And they are all involuntary in nature, meaning that I cannot control the actions of my organs. It is all being controlled by my brain. So in asanas, when Guruji says bring organic action in asanas, what does it mean? When I cannot reach the organs, how to reach those organs if they are involuntary? Slide. The answer is via skeletomuscular system and nervous system. Next slide. Okay, now limbic system. Before telling this, I want to tell this, tell why I have chosen this topic. We have heard about, liver, heart, pancreas, and other abdominal organs in our daily asana classes, a very commonly cited examples. But today I wanted to take this opportunity to shed some light on a very less commonly talked about organ in our body that plays a very important role in our asana practice, limbic system. Now this limbic system, we have something called as limbic system. The three main organs are there: hypothalamus, hippocampus, and amygdala. I'm not going to talk about amygdala now, but as you can see in this picture, brain and spinal cord forms the central nervous system. Now these two organs, hypothalamus and hippocampus, they are situated somewhere inside the brain, core brain. Okay. Now the spinal cord, imagine the spinal cord is 45 centimeters long. Imagine it is really 45 centimeters long, and it reaches till the somewhere between L1 and L2, lumbar 1 and lumbar 2, somewhere between that it ends. So that much long the spinal cord is. Now the next figure is the cross section of the brain showing the hypothalamus and the brainstem. Brainstem is nothing but the continuation of it is nothing but the spinal cord. Okay, but the top of the spinal cord is called as medulla oblongata. As you can see, the hypothalamus, the pink color one, it's a very small region, the hypothalamus. It is situated somewhere near the core of the brain. Okay, now it has got a very vital role. It controls all major endocrine functions. And name anything in your body, sleep, emotion, behavior, hunger, reproductive cycle, temperature regulation, hormones, anything in your body, hypothalamus controls it. And which is why I have chosen these systems today. Next slide. Hippocampus. Now you can see below the hypothalamus, hippocampus is there. Now this hypothalamus, I told you, it is just an almond-sized organ. So small it is, almond-sized. Below this hypothalamus is hippocampus. This is also a part of limbic system. Now, what is its role? It converts short-term memory into long-term memory. Now, once this region is damaged, you don't want this. Okay. If this region is damaged, new memory just fades away. There will not be any new memory, fresh memories formed at all. Whatever memories just come, they just go away. That's it. Okay, slide. And it is mainly concerned with homeostasis. Homeostasis, I'll talk to you in a while. It receives information from vagus nerves. Vagus nerves is one of the, is the largest of the cranial muscles. It's the largest of the cranial nerves. And it runs almost to any organ in the body, almost every organ in the body, till the gut, till the intestines, from the brain, from the brain to all organs in our body, this vagus nerves runs. You would have heard about Guruji telling, calming the vagus nerves in forward bending asanas. So vagus nerves communicates to the hippocampus through those channels. Slide. Now, this is the only region in the brain to have neurogenesis. Neurogenesis means the ability to form new brain cells by stem cells. Stem cells means that they can be transformed to any kind of cell in our body. So we have the stem cells have that power. Okay. Now, it is important for us to understand now at birth, we have about 14 billion cells in our brain. We have about 14 billion cells in our brain, and the number does not increase at all. And after 25 years of age, 100,000 cells die every day. And after 40 years of age, the numbers decline sharply. And after 50 years of age, your neural cells starts dying. And your brain becomes smaller. So this is what is happening in your body, okay, as age progresses. Now, the reason is that I find it really amazing why when Guruji does this hypothalamus curvature via asana, setubandhasana and all that, it was really, you know, I got shocked. My God, I'm already reaching about, you know, I'm nearing 40. My brain cells are already dying. Next slide. It's scary. Yes. Now, no. Hypothalamus slide. Hippocampus slide, please. Yes. Now, this hippocampus, I told you, I was telling you about these many cells die, which means that the brain cells, they don't have the ability to form new cells, right? But scientists have found out that this hippocampus is the only region, and hypothalamus is the only region that has got the stem cell activity. No other region in the brain has got this stem cells. So that is why those people who are with chronic depression, scientists have shown that this hippocampus has shown a tremendous shrinkage. That region has shrunk in people with chronic depression. Okay, next slide. I'm just trying to tell you why these kind of asanas are, next slide, asanas, yes. Why these asanas are very important, you know, very, very important. Now, asanas with hypothalamus curvature. Now you can see asanas like Setubandhasan, Kapotasan, front view. You can see the front view I have chosen on purpose because how much he has taken his head back. And in Urdhva Dhanurasana, how much he has taken his head back. With this picture that has been shown in the side, anatomy of the brain, you can relate where the brain is and why we should take the head back, why that curvature is very important to reach that, even that small organs, hypothalamus and hippocampus, it is possible only through brainstem. And that is why these asanas, curvature asanas, are very important for your good brain health. Now, when you look at Setubandhasana, yes, so can you please point me? You can see all those slides that Guruji is taking his head back. But be careful, just don't think that just because I'm taking my head back, it doesn't mean that I'm curving my hypothalamus. It doesn't work like that. Yeah, the slide. In asanas like Setubandhasana, it is also because of a combination of factors, like how his hands and legs are, how rest of the vertebral column, how the rest of the vertebral column is, where the position of the organs are, say for example, kidneys, liver, heart, etc., how they are placed in a particular way in order to have that much effect on or impact on hypothalamus. So everything is very vital. Now you can see in Setubandhasana, Urdhva Dhanurasana and Kapotasana, they are all taking the head back. Whereas in asanas like Sarvangasana and Setubandha Sarvangasana, the chin is towards the chest. It is the opposite side action. So why these two asanas are also important is because to maintain the cervical length and taking the head back. Doing these two asanas, example, these two asanas will lengthen your cervical spine. And thereby, with the maintaining this cervical spine, along with the rest of the vertebral column, then you take the head back to reach the even the smallest of the organs like hypothalamus and hippocampus. Next slide. Next slide. Now, I told you why I was telling you about a wide range of asanas. Now, why asanas have to be done in combinations? This is the picture of showing the abdominal organs. But I'm just taking one example here in case of liver. It's a very commonly cited example, organ, liver. Who knew that, you know, it has got nearly 500 known vital functions. You cannot imagine how vital the organ is. Now, in very simple terms, when this organ fails, then none of the toxic material from our body will be removed. Toxic substances will be accumulated. That is the importance of liver. Now, the same organ like liver can be targeted via different asanas. But each asana has got its own unique procedure and result. How? Say for example, liver, when doing Supta Virasana or Purvottanasana, for example, the frontal part, the anterior part of the liver is getting stretched. doing Mayurasana or forward bends, you get a gentle massage for your liver. For when you are doing Janusheshasana or Paschimottanasana, again the abdomen compression comes. That is again a different condition for liver. In backbending asanas, again the posterior part of the liver is getting stretched. So what about the anterior sides of the liver? Think of the liver as a three-dimensional figure, not as one-dimensional thing. So what about the lateral sides of the liver? Here again, the importance of twisting comes. The lateral sides of the organs can be accessed by twisting asanas. Now here again, what the chest and the stomach does, what the kidneys does in Ushtrasana is different from what they are doing in Marishasana. And that is why the outcome in all these asanas are different, right? Okay, you just would have heard Geetaji talking about Samakrama and Vishamakrama, Anulomakrama and Pratilomakrama. All those things, this is why the asanas ought to be done in combinations. A single organ can be targeted via different asanas, and different organs can be targeted by a single asana. That is also possible. Next slide. So I was telling you about nerves, right? So coming, we have to basically understand that I don't want to complicate things too much, but we have to understand that our body has basically two different kinds of nerves. One is afferent and one is efferent. Okay. And this afferent nerves, it carries information from the body to the brain. And this efferent nerves, it carries information from the body, brain to the body. Now in this picture, this is how the nerve cells will look. The nerve cells will look like this only under a microscope. And as you can see in the picture beneath it, this is how the nervous system is, how the nerves run throughout the body, starting from your brain and the spinal cord. They form the basis of all the things because that is the central nervous system. So basically this is how it works. Our hands and legs work in asanas, okay? Now, through hands and legs, they carry the information to the brain. Now, from the brain, it has to say that, yes, I have received some information from the hands and legs. So let me tell my organs what to do. So now brain will communicate to the rest of the organs via hormones, that again, efferent nerves. Thereby, the target organs are reached. And this is how organic action comes into picture. And this is what means when Guruji said, bring organic action in asanas. So it is via nerves. And do you even know, see, it's a fun fact. Information zooms along the nerves about 400 kilometers per hour. Wow. And I also came to know about this. Neuroscientists, they found out that they say that the human brain can see the entire image that the eye see as fast as 13 milliseconds. 13 milliseconds. How fast the embodiment is, how fast the signal goes. Okay, next slide. Now I was telling you about twisting asanas, right? The twisting comes into picture. So why twisting asanas? Now, twisting asanas, personally, they hold a very close to place in my heart, because Guruji made me all those things, and Parivrata Pashvakonasana is still a very, I don't know, it doesn't come to me at all. I still struggle with it, but still, thank God, he made me do twisting more, very, very often. But for some reason, twisting group of asanas is very close to my heart. So in twisting asanas, what happens? The spine is getting rotated. Yes, you know that it strengthens the spinal and the paraspinal muscles. It is good for a wide variety of problems, back pain, neck pain, shoulder pain. Again, as I said, they are all obvious. So what is not obvious in twisting asanas? Let us look. Next slide. Now, this is again a closer look at the spine in twisting asanas. Now, when the head, neck and the head, neck and the back, when they you turn to the one side, it is called as lateral flexion. The first picture, lateral flexion of the spine. So this is what is happening in Trikonasana. You can connect it, you can relate it. How the vertebral column changes the shape. How you tend to, when you turn to one side in as in Trikonasana, how the shape of the vertebral column is, right? Now, when rotation of the spine happens, the spine itself rotates, as you can see in Parivrita Trikonasana. Next slide. Now I told you, yes, the skeletomuscular system, the vertebral column rotates, they are all very obvious actions. So what is not obvious in these things is the physiology behind these group of asanas, as I told you. Now we have something called as stretch receptors in our body. Now, what are these stretch receptors? They are present in our, in all our muscles, cells, hands, legs, colon, heart, lungs, name anything in your body, they are there. So what is its role? Is that it will gather information regarding the length of the muscle and the velocity at which the muscle lengthens, or there if there is a lengthens or stretches or whatever action. Okay, so it is going to gather that information from the body, and it is going to send this information to the spinal cord. Spinal cord means central nervous system. And the spinal cord will again talk to other organ systems. Or for example, suppose you have a catch. You do Supta Padangushtasana, one, if you have a hamstring catch. You do twisting when you have a back sprain or catch and all that. So somewhere there's a pain quotient in that. So this is how the signal goes from the pain area to the brain. Now the brain, after processing all these things, you know, how much velocity the muscles are stretching and what is the length of the muscles, then accordingly, it would release all those pain relievers to the target site. This is how it has been a boon to release catches, cramps, and all that. Okay, this is the physiology behind twisting group of asanas. Now these stretch receptors, they are, I understand that these are very complex things, but when you learn about these things, how they work in twisting, in other group of asanas, in pranayama, it's an amazing topic. It's really mind blowing. This is how the muscular system looks. And these are our spindle fibers. This is how your muscle fibers look. Next slide. Now, Geetaji used to say that twisting group of asanas are neutralizing asanas. Why? Say, for example, you are in an advanced class. Now the teacher, I can imagine Abhi or Raya telling you this, do Urdhva Dhanurasana 10 times, up and down, up and down, up and down. Do rope one, come, do. Then full arm balance, again, jump. Jumping asanas, motion, any intensive asanas, for example, when you do all those things, what happens to your body? What are the immediate things that happens to your body? Your body temperature increases, right? Your body temperature increases. Your heartbeat increases, your blood pressure increases, you gasp for more air, and the blood sugar also increases. Now these are all off normalcy, right? So these things are, these changes, physiological changes that are brought about by sympathetic nervous system. Now all these actions cannot remain as it is. They have to revert back. I have to go back to my normal state. So my teacher says, okay, in between you all come down, do Uttanasana where the intense stretch is there, do twisting asana so that they will save us from getting a catch or a cramp. That is what our teachers do. Now, what happens in during twisting? Slide. As I told you, the stretch receptors in the previous slide, they talk to us. Okay, they talk to the brain, the muscle fibers, they talk to the brain via these stretch receptors. And the muscle fiber, next slide, please. So indicating that these changes had happened in your body. Now the brain stem then sends to the various organs to reverse all these actions. Then that time, the parasympathetic nervous system takes over. So what happens as this, that process where they're bringing a balance between all these variables is called as homeostasis. Homeostasis is nothing but a regulation of the internal environment, where all these things, as I told you, heart rate, body temperature, blood sugar levels, blood pressure, they have to be in a harmonic state in your body. That is homeostasis. If you remember, if you recollect what I told you in the hypothalamus and hippocampus region, those two organs controls this homeostasis. Now you can relate why I am bringing all those things today, right? Now the parasympathetic nervous system takes over, right? So what happens? What happens to the normalcy? Sweating occurs to lower my body temperature. My heart rate will come down. My blood pressure will also be controlled. Okay, but understand, all these things, they're all brought about by hormones. They're all brought about by hormones. So this way, the endocrine system comes into play. First, we started with musculoskeletal system. Then we started with the nervous system. Nervous system, again, there is a connection with the endocrine system. Endocrine system comes into play. This way, all the networks, all the organ systems in our body works as a network. But for my understanding's sake, I'm just cutting into pieces, nervous system, muscular system. But it doesn't work like that in our body. It doesn't work like that. Everything, all organ systems work together in order to strike a balance. Slide. Now, yes, next slide. When I joined Prashantji's classes, he used to say body for the mind, mind for the breath, breath for the mind, all those combinations. I never understood it. Okay. It was all, overwhelming for me. But I used to wonder what they are. Now, when you learn, when you sit and look at all these factors, probably he was talking about this homeostasis, mind for the breath, body for the mind, breath for the mind, body, and all that. So you can all understand how relatable they are. Now, the same organ can play different roles in different asanas under different conditions, both external and internal. External means it can relate to weather, time, say for morning, afternoon, evening. It can be a rainy season, summer season, or winter. Your physiology changes. It's different in all these things. Your physiology itself is different in mornings, evenings, and at night, right? In the mornings, your kapha is more. And in the afternoon time, your pitta component is more. And in evening time, your vata component is more. They are all playing a dominant roles in different parts of a day. So this way you can understand even your physiology is not constant throughout the day. And that is why when you do Shirshasana, Sarvangasana in the morning, it gives you a different effect. When you do it in the afternoon, it gives you a different effect. When you do it in the night, the evening time, it gives you a different effect. Slide. Now I was telling this body and mind, it has got a two-way relationship. Okay. Agreed. Now, for example, you cannot deny it. The mind has got a very important role on the body, the status of the health of the individual. For example, when you take stress, it causes acidity, indigestion, body ache, fatigue, headache, vomiting, etc. Now, when the body is, when the mind is stressed, it means that the sympathetic nervous system is taking over. So, which means that the adrenaline is high in your blood. Whatever organs in your blood functions differently, thereby a different physiology is there. But whereas when your body, when your mind is calm, your parasympathetic nervous system takes over, right? So that is how it plays. That time that the adrenaline level in your body is less, and all your organs functions differently, and thereby a different physiology. This is how the aim of asanas should be. Prashantji used to, he told me this, that we have to aim for seasoning of the organs. It's a beautiful term. I loved it. Seasoning of the organs. What do you call a good health? That the physiology, the organs, their function should not change no matter whatever the conditions are. Whatever the external and external conditions are, your internal conditions should not change. It should work in a harmonic state. And that is what the aim of asanas should be. Seasoning, beautiful term, seasoning of the organs. And that is called as a good health. Now, the takeaway of today's presentation will be, the asanas, they don't have a fixed physiology. They help you to have a better physiology. Now, the effect of asanas can be understood only when they are done in combinations. Now, I cannot just be lying down in Supta Virasana and expect a good health. I cannot be just doing Supta Patangushtasana or some other one asana and expect a good health. You have to do a series of asanas, wide variety of asanas, whatever your target is, starting from a simple thing to advanced thing, whatever, how much ever you can, there has to be a combination of asanas in order to understand the effect of asanas. Hamstring becomes long, the catch releases, they are all very obvious things. But we have to, as Guruji said, that we should train ourselves to look at the not obvious things. Slide. Next slide. So it's there, the seasoning of the organs. Now end your practice with Shavasana. Geeta ji, in her Shavasana classes, she used to say, keep your brain cells quiet. Can you even imagine that about more than 100,000 chemical reactions occur in your brain every second? That's huge. That's really huge. And about 20% of the blood supply goes to the brain alone. That's highest. So you end your practice with Shavasana. You give some time for whatever the chemical changes had happened in your body, desired changes, good changes that had happened in your body, be it molecular, physiological, psychological, it can be anything. They have to be imbibed. They have to be absorbed into your each and every cell into your body. So Shavasana gives you that platform. When you go back to your home after asana, you just go back to your day-to-day routine. There is no time for the cells to absorb all the good things. And that is why you give some time for, there has to be some transformation phase between your asana practice and your day-to-day normal lives. And that is why the importance of Shavasana comes. As Guruji puts it, each and every cell in your body should get transformed. Slide. Now, I told you that whatever we are doing is a part of Swadhyaya. Now, how can I progress in my Swadhyaya? Swadhyaya is self-study. Now, how can I progress in my Swadhyaya? I can incorporate all these factors. Shariras, what are the layers of shariras? I can bring nadis, chakras, mudras. As your practice progresses, all these things will obviously, they will come into picture, right? Now you can see where this jnanendriyas, organs of perception, organs of actions, all those things, koshas, the list is never ending. You just can't, there is no stopping you from your Swadhyaya. But for today, just remember that Annamaya kosha deals with the anatomy. And pranamaya kosha means physiology. Okay, that will be to keep it simple. Okay, next slide. Okay, what after this? If my aim is just to get you all fascinated about the human body, yes, my job is already done. Probably you would have been fascinated by looking all those numbers, stretch receptors. She's talking something about molecular changes. Most of you might have get fascinated. But is it my aim? Not just that. Is it about meeting daily energy or strength quota? Or is yoga just about getting a good health? No. Now, when you pursue yoga, spirituality, or philosophy, at some point or the other, you will all come across this concept of beyond at some point or the other, right? What is beyond is left to your imagination. But for me, let me tell you, who created all these things? Can you please show me face? Yeah, for me personally, who created all these things? Who created all these molecular switches? How come all these signal transduction happening? How are the cells communicating all these things? But my scientific brain says evolution. I can give a very simple answer. Evolution, it's nature given. But my emotional brain says that evolution, okay. Evolution is not a single day process. It's a very long process, right? Now, we are here today because evolution made mistakes. A lot of mistakes happened genetically. You can say mutation happened. You can say those organisms never survived before we existed. Now, who decided all those mistakes have to be corrected? And who decided what has to be done that those mistakes can be corrected? All these are all metaphysical questions. And this is how the spirituality comes into picture. The more you learn about all those things, the more you will realize that you do not know anything at all. The more you think that you do not know anything at all, then you get to surrender to the some superior concept. And that, according to me, is beyond. Slide. It's amazing. It's really amazing to see and understand how life exists, you know. But that's the beauty of Ashtanga Yoga, I believe. That's the beauty of Ashtanga Yoga. Philosophy and spirituality gets gradually introduced to you. It doesn't come in the beginning only. It doesn't come at all. Only anatomy, physiology comes in the beginning. Then gradually, philosophy and spirituality gets introduced so that you don't become clueless. You don't become overwhelmed. You don't become scared. You don't become scared looking at the unknown. And that's the beauty of Ashtanga Yoga. That is why I believe what I believe that Patanjali did via his teachings. That is what I believe that Guruji did via his teachings. I will, next slide. I will end my presentation by saying this, reciting this sloka. Kayena vacha manasendriyaiva buddhyatmanava prakrite svabhavat karomi yajit sakalam patasmai narayanayati samarpayami. So it means that those who recite Vishnu Sahasranam very often, they are very familiar with the sloka. It comes at the end. I also end my presentation with this sloka. It means that whatever I do with my body, can you please show my face? Yes. Whatever I do with my body, with my speech, with my hands, with my organs of actions, with my senses, with my intellect, with my heart, whatever I do not owe them at all. I do not owe them. I just surrender them to the Lord of the feet of Lord Narayan. That's what it means. I surrender everything to the Lord. And that is what Ishwara Pranidhana is. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for your patience. With this, I end my presentation. Back to Sunita ji.
Sunita ji, back to
Dailakunjamala. Very good, Pavitra. It was really very nice. You explained it in a very well manner. I will just give 2 minutes to just find out if anybody wants to ask question. You can just ask so that she will be able to answer. So in that case, you better put your question to the chat so that she will be able to see that question and will be able to answer. So again on Pavitra.
Yes. Abhi, can you please put the last slide where you can see the email ID, where you can get a hold of my email ID. Rest all, you know where to catch hold of me. For those who can't, can you see this is my email ID at the bottom, pavi.raghavan@gmail.com. You can email me if there is any feedback. It can be bad, it can be good, anything. Just let me know. If there is anything that I know to my within my limited knowledge, I'll be able to tell you. If not, I'll consult Prashantji or Sunitaji and I'll let you know. Right? I'm also learning along with you all. I'm also just a student. Yes? Is there anything, Sunitaji?
Anybody just now want to ask, they can ask.
Yes. You can unmute yourself and you can talk. If there is anything, if there's anything anybody has to say.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yes.
And thank you so much for such an excellent presentation. Madam, can I speak, madam?
Yes, yes. Please. Yeah.
So, madam, I can understand what is japa, what is bhavana, what is artha in practicing of asana. If you can just speak one or two sentences on that, it would
artha,
really help me.
Artha is purpose. You cannot just, that's what I said in the beginning. If you can recollect what I told you in the beginning, that I cannot pursue yoga just because I feel closer to God. I cannot pursue yoga just because I feel closer to my guru. That's not a purpose at all. It doesn't solve the purpose. What is the ultimate purpose is up to you. You have to search your own purpose. For each and every one, the purpose differs. Why you have been created, why you exist, your purpose is different. This artha, as what in what context Geetaji said, was doing asanas, every asana should be done with japa, artha and bhavana. Bhavana means expression. You have to express yourself. That is how Guruji's asanas are an art. He, whatever has been experienced by him, it has been expressed outside as asanas. And that is why it's an art. Japa is doing Sheshasana up and down repeatedly is japa. Anything that you do repeatedly is japa. Artha is purpose. Bhavana is the expression. That has to be there.
Okay, madam. Thank you so much.
You got my point, right?
Yeah, ma'am. So we got when, point.
See, it's a very complicated question. Purpose. What is your own purpose in your life that you have to search? I cannot, I will not be knowing your purpose in your life, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, there is a question by Rajkumar Kodke that he's asking, the dying process of brain cells with age get reversed with emergence. Is it possible?
I have not... I will be lying honestly if I say, without any proof, if I say yes, you will hit me.
Just a minute. You have to unmute yourself. Please unmute yourself, speaker.
Yes. Now, yes, inversions, as again, I told you, you were asking about the reversion of maybe the dying process can be slowed down. The progression of the disease can be slowed down by doing inversions. Now the circulatory system of the brain is completely different. You have to, that is not the exact what you have in rest of the body parts. The circulatory system of the brain is a completely different topic. Like I said, it's a very vast ocean, you know. You cannot just gather everything at a moment. So give me some time. As I said, probably the progression of the dying process has been slowed down by doing inversions, which is why you have to do inversions daily. And it is not just the circulatory system that has been involved. It is also the endocrine system. It is also the lymphatic system. Multiple parameters are involved in inversions.
Hello.
Hi, Lois.
Hi. I put a link on the chat that shows that Hatha yoga practitioners that they measured the gray matter in their brains, which is what decreases, that in Hatha yoga practitioners, it actually stays increased and doesn't decrease. And okay. I put a link in the chat for that. There's actually research that shows
that yoga.
Okay, the person who had asked me this question, Lois is saying that she has posted a link in the chat where you can find your answer. Sunita ji, is there anything else, or can we end the session?
Yes, we can end the session. Thank you very much, Pavitra. It was very nice. Keep it up with your own studies, Swadhyaya, and all the best.
Yes, God thank bless. You. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very
thank
much.
You. Thank you. Thank you, Sunita ji.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pavitra.